Hello and welcome to the SANFL show. My name's Zach Milbank and joining me on today's show is SANFL High Performance Manager Brenton Phillips and also Sturt star midfielder Richard Tambling, also the Diversity Programs Manager here at the SANFL. Guys, thank you very much for joining us today.
And Stoke squad member you should put in
too. Of course, yes. Man of many talents is Rich, indeed. So thank you very much for joining us today on the couch.
Thanks for having us.
Before we get into, I guess, the reasons we've got both of your presence here today, we'll have a look at the round and round seven that's obviously just been completed on the weekend. Saw some one tight result, obviously Glenelg getting up over Central by a goal down at the Bay. Jacob Carger kicking the sealer there, I think 24 minutes into the final term. And of course some lopsided results as well. Rich, obviously your beloved Double Blues getting up comfortably over West Adelaide at Investor Park, and also Woodville West Torrens getting up comfortably over North Adelaide at Mourntean Hyundai. You must be really pleased with how your boys in particular are tracking.
Yeah, definitely. We've had two losses now on both weekends. After that, we've tracked pretty well and came back with wins, big wins both rounds. So on the weekend was a four-quarter performance, which everyone performed pretty well in, so it was great.
Because I was going to say, you had a really even spread of goal kickers, didn't you? I think just about every player almost got on the goal sheet there at one stage.
Yeah, I can't seem to get near the sticks at the moment, but look, it's an even spread and we're all playing our role and it's working very well.
Yeah, and of course the Magpies continued on their merry way, defeating South Adelaide quite comfortably there at Alberton in what was a top-of-the-table clash, so they're going to be tough to beat, the Maggies, but of course the Eagles are right there with them, level on the ladder. It's just percentage separating the two at the moment. My highlight of the round was definitely the high scoring and also the spearheads of the competition having some days out. Michael Newton for Nord in their win over Adelaide, kicking eight goals. Fantastic to see the Juicer getting up there and getting into some nice form. And also the Twin Towers at the Eagles, Michael Wunke and Andrew Ainger, kicking 13 majors between them is a fair effort, isn't it, Sticks? It's almost a throwback to the halcyon days of the SANFL in the 1980s, isn't it?
Yeah, when you take they're probably a groky to roll back into that lineup as the season unfolds. So they've got some pretty good firepower up forward. I suppose they could probably roll groky back to centre half back if they want to stitch that end of the ground up. So they've got some really strong firepower. Look, it's going to go down really well. I'm really excited about the SANFL season, how it's going to progress. You know, you've got Port Adelaide at one end that's is probably the dominant side, and then you've got a few chasing.
Yeah, definitely.
And the one thing that really highlights to me is the adjunct of Port Adelaide and Adelaide coming. It's actually lifted the competition.
It's actually said,
well, you've got to chase us. So there's some coaches and that doing some really good homework at the moment, working out how they can counteract these clubs. So it's fantastic for the competition.
Indeed it is. Now, speaking of coaches doing homework, I understand you were doing some of that on the weekend. Obviously, one of the key reasons you're on the couch today is to talk about the South Australia's campaign at the National Under-18 Championships, which begins on Saturday at Amy Stadium against WA. And you saw the Victorian heavyweights go toe-to-toe on the weekend.
Yeah, look, that'll be fantastic at Amy Stadium. I really encourage anybody to get along. It's free entry to get into the ground on Saturday. It'll be a fantastic contest. West Australia are a really crack outfit. They've got a couple of Indigenous kids, you know, Pickett's and Clem Smith, and a couple of these lads that are fantastic and really hard and good team type players. So it's going to be a cracking contest. So if you can get down to Amy on Saturday, it'd be well worth seeing the next generation of talent coming through. But yes, I went across to Melbourne on the weekend. I just wanted to go across and catch up with the Vic Country Vic Metro game. And the country boys, the boys from the bush, got them by 15 points at the end of the day, and it was a really interesting game. I thought Metro probably had their measure most of the day, but country just found a way to get across the line in the end, so it was an entertaining game of football.
Who do you think looms as the favourite to take out the title? Obviously, we've seen a change in the structure of the competition this year.
Yeah, look, if we go back 2 years at the under-16s, this Western Australian group were very good to come through, and they were coached by Robert Wiley at that point in time, and they actually won that championships that year. So they were a really good good organisation, but you never underestimate the country and the Metro boys. The Division 1 competition is a very high standard of competition. There's some quick ball movements, some really good football play. There's some big men that play the game. You know, like the average key forward probably stands about 195, 196 centimetres, and they're just big athletic young men at this point in time, so it's a crack outfit.
Yeah, it certainly is. And of course, we should mention that South Australia won the title last year, Sticks. It was
never
a drought
mentioning that.
Drought breaking performance. Well, very proud of it, being proud South Aussies as we are. But obviously this year's squad changed somewhat through the national draft naturally, but how we should are sort of shaping in terms of I guess the key thing is just having some key position type players, isn't it?
We are, yeah, and we're starting to get that. There's a young lad from the Sturt Football Club, Tom Reed. Mm. He stands 200 centimetres. We plonked him at full forward. He can catch it and find it off the ground. So he's a talent. Sam Durden, everyone's been speaking about. He's 196 or 7 centimetre. Can play in the ruck. Can play key forward, key defence. He's really good. Young Keenan Ramsey from the Port Adelaide Football Club. He's been on the radar for a little bit of time, and he's playing at a key defensive role for us. So he's in a about the mark there. So yeah, we've got some really good talent coming through our squad, so I'm really looking forward to it.
We should mention as well, Billy Stretch, the son of Stephen Stretch, he's tracking quite well, isn't he, Sticks?
Yeah, Billy's going really well, and then Jake Johansson pops up and plays a little bit of a cameo role for us on Friday night when we played against Norwood's combined side. And we've got young Caleb Daniels, who's just coming back from an ankle injury. So I'm hoping he'll be up and running in a couple of weeks' time, and we can slot him back into the side also.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because we've had some injury issues, because obviously Durden had the thumb sprain earlier on, and he's got over that. And really pleasing to hear that Caleb's close to returning, and Jake Johansson's returned from his injury issue. But another one bobbed up on the weekend, Peter Bampton, obviously from Nord, might have hurt his ankle.
Yeah, he did. He rang me Saturday, and then I rang him back Sunday, and we sort of got talking about it. He'll have an MRI on the ankle. He'll have the doctors check it out. Ankles are one of those ones that can either be no weeks or 2 or 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping it's on the no week side. Even if it is the 2 or 3 weeks, we can get him involved in the back end of the championships when we perhaps go to Melbourne and get a bit, I suppose, heavier grounds over there.
Indeed. You mentioned the back end of the championships. At the front end, obviously some games at Amy Stadium this year. Last year we only had the one game in South Australia, and that was at City Mazda Stadium, but nice to get out on the deck of Amy 3 occasions this season.
Yeah, Western Australia obviously is the kick-off. We'll then play Vic Country the week after. We'll go to Perth and have the rematch in Perth with the WA boys, come back to Adelaide for the game against Metro. We'll have a bye, and then we'll head to Melbourne and play the last two games, which is against Country and Metro again back in Melbourne.
Now, we're very excited to see how the National Under 18 Championships unfolds for South Australia and the boys. Sticks, we wish you all the best. Obviously the game on the weekend at Amy against WA kicks off at midday, so as Sticks mentioned, get down there and see some of the best talent on show. They are the future. There'll be a lot of those boys will be playing in the AFL the next season. And one man who's travelled that path is Richard Tambling, obviously. He's now at the other end of his career, and Rich, you must be really enjoying your time at Sturt. Obviously, strung together some really strong form in the midfield there for the Double Blues.
Yeah, definitely. Obviously, the team's winning, so everything's going great at the moment. The transition from AFL to SANFL's been pretty good. Obviously, my job here at the SANFL's formed giving me that platform to leap onto my next phase of my career, and it's going well at the moment.
Sure.
Family's happy, and that's important.
Indeed it is. You mentioned the next phase of your career. Can you just enlighten the viewers as to what your role exactly is at the SANFL?
I'll work with the diversity programs within the SANFL. It covers a range of things, multicultural football, Indigenous football, female footy, and inclusion programs. So it covers a wide range, as you can imagine. Anything diverse is sort of underneath the banner of my group, and it's going really well. It's a lot to take in, but you get a lot of reward for it, so it's been good.
Yeah, indeed. And we should also mention that you're in charge of some trainees at the SANFL. If you could just enlighten
us. No, they've been great.
A little bit more about that program and how that all works.
Yeah, look, they're SASTA graduates, so South Australian Aboriginal Sports Training Academy graduates, and we've taken on 15 this year, and they spread across a multiple host of organisations, including SAPOL here at the SANFL. Mm. A couple of the SANFL teams have a few of them, so yeah. And they're in education systems as well. So they're doing a whole range of stuff, and they've been great. They come together for 3 days every month and go through a part of their training, and it's been sensational having them around the place, and hopefully they can take away valuable experiences, and their careers can develop from here on in.
And do you really enjoy acting as a mentor for them as well?
Oh, I do. It gets rough at times. No, they told me to say that. No, it's great. They're a lovely bunch of people, and they're sitting in the back at the moment.
Yeah, the pressure's on.
I've got to say something nice. No, but it's been great. Look, as I said, they're graduates, and they're well-developed young adults now, so it's good working with them.
Looking back on the field, we've got a question from our work experience student, Kai, to throw at you. It's a tough, grinding one, but he wants to know, Sturt's premiership chances this year, can you win the flag?
Oh, look, we're just, as every team, we're aiming week to week. I have Emmanuel Airy in my ear every day telling me Souths are going to win. So, look, we just take it week by week, and we know what makes us play well now, and as long as we implement that, we give it our best shot. And if we end up winning on the day, then we win. If we lose, as long as we know we've given it our best shot.
One thing that's noticeable about the Double Blues this year is your stability, especially at the selection table. Obviously, you don't have anywhere near as many of those Crows listed players coming and going weekly.
Yeah, but it's also the guys, the 19, 20, 21 year olds have really stepped up this year. You know, the Matty Crocker, who normally does the tagging role, he's tagging as well as bagging goals. So, guys like that, Tom Bartlett, Tommy Harms, there's a whole range of guys who are starting to make a statement in league footy, and that's what we need. And as long as we keep those bloke on the track with a bit of continuity, it's going to be great for us in the future.
It's really good from the point of view that they're actually Sturt homegrown young men. They're not imported in from other clubs, so it's a real feather in the cap of their development through the Sturt Football Club there.
Yeah, and it's been good to keep them over the years. Obviously, with the AFL players coming back and forth, it's no doubt a tough gig for homegrown players to come to training every week and wait until the last minute to get the call up or not. Whereas now we know early on in the week who's in and who's out, and the coaches can plan for that, and it's been great.
I'm tipping that Seamus Maloney would get so many phone calls on a Friday afternoon either.
Yeah, exactly. Now look, I don't try and bug him too much, so it's been good.
And no doubt Seamus has already begun planning right into his planning with this week's round of matches, round 8 of the SANFL IGA League. It kicks off on Friday night, Nord and the Eagles at Coopers Stadium from 7:40 p.m. Sticko, who do you think will win this one?
Well, that'll be a cracking game. I watched a bit of the Nord-Adelaide game on Friday night because we played prior to them. Adelaide were very good in the first quarter, and I left the game thinking, oh, how far by Adelaide? And then got home and flicked over to the Sample app and saw that Nord come storming home. So, look, this is going to be a great game. I just reckon the Eagles' firepower up forward might be a bit much for them. Mm. Now, if they get a wet night,
Rich, who do you think?
Yeah, look, the Eagles at the moment, they're tracking along well, and they've obviously got a very, very experienced and talented forward line, so I have to go with that.
Now, I agree with you both. I think the Eagles will just get over the line, although Nord are warming up ominously, so it'll be interesting to see. Central District versus Sturt at Playford Alive Oval on Saturday at 2:10 p.m. Sticko, who do you think?
I can't go past the Blues, mate.
You're under pressure there.
I can go Blues as well, mate.
And why, I guess, looking at your opponent more so, Rich, how can you overcome Central?
Yeah, look, it's obviously a big ground, and it's been their domain for a number of years now. We've just got to, as I mentioned, those things that make us play well, the defensive pressure and setting up our structures, that's all we've got to get right. And whether we win on the day, it doesn't matter, as long as we're trying our hardest and doing the things that we've implemented during the week.
No doubt, I think the Double Blues will continue their strong form and get a win up there at the Ponderosa. North Adelaide and Port Adelaide at Prospect Oval, 2:10 p.m. on Saturday. Sticko, another one of your old clubs here involved.
Yeah, look, North have been up and down, haven't they? They haven't really held their form line together. They'd be a really good test against Port. They'll put them to the sword. So just can't see North getting across them at the moment.
Yeah. Bridge.
Port are just tracking along very nicely at the moment, so I'll have to go with them.
Yeah, I've got to agree with you both there as well. Port Adelaide for me in that one. West Adelaide and Glenelg in the MAC game of the round on Channel 7, 2:10 p.m. on Saturday. Sticko, who do you think?
Look, I'll only go with West because it's at their home ground. So yeah. They weren't real convincing on the weekend, West, and I'm not sure that Glenelg were overly convincing getting across Central. So, just home ground advantage, I'm going with West.
Rich?
Yeah, I'll have to say the same. They've both got pretty strong inside mids. It's a matter of who gets it on the spread, and I'm going to go with Westies.
Yeah, pretty boring. I'm going to agree with you as well. I think West Adelaide at City Mazda Stadium, I think they'll be very fired up. Mark Micken will be into them about their work rate. He was heavily critical about that against Sturt at Unley in round seven. So I think they'll respond. On Sunday, we've got a standalone fixture. South Adelaide against Adelaide at Hickenbotham Oval from the special time of 1:10 p.m. Sticks, who do you think will win?
Yeah, look, I thought Adelaide were coming along okay. It's just the second half of their games has sort of been non-competitive, really. And look, South have shown that they are the real deal, I reckon, at this point in time. So South for mine.
Rich?
Yeah, my work colleague E-Man would be very disappointed if I don't tip South, but I'm going to go with them. Obviously, they spread very well down there. It's a big deck, and they're going to look for a reply after the weekend's performance, so I'm going to have to go with them.
Yeah, South Adelaide, they're certainly making Hickenbotham Oval a fortress yet again, so I think they'll get over the line there. All very similar, weren't we, boys? Not too much disagreement there, but... play on. Well, thanks very much for joining us on the couch, Sticko. We look forward to having you on again at some stage this year, and likewise as well, Rich. Thank you very much for joining us. We look forward to having you on again, perhaps in the lead up to Indigenous round. We'll have you back on the couch yet again to have a chat about all of that, but thank you very much both for joining us.
Thank you
very much for all of you, the viewers, for joining us on the SANFL show for this week. We look forward to joining you again next week.